morning and a very warm welcome once again to our time of worship together. And today is Sunday the 13th of September. A very warm welcome. Thank you for joining with us wherever you are and whenever you are joining in on our online time together. And today we are continuing our little series in life and worship in the early church. And having now looked at prayer and mission and hospitality in the early church, today we'll be thinking about learning in the early church. And we'll think about that a little bit later on in our reading and our reflections together. As we come together to worship God now, we take some moments of stillness as we come into his presence and gather our scattered thoughts and focus upon him now. And our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 19 and some of its verses, where we read, "The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The decrees of the Lord are sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and drippings of the honeycomb. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer." And in the words of the psalmist there, as we join together to sing our opening hymn of praise this morning, we join to praise God in the words of hymn 6, "God shall endure for aye." Let us pray. Almighty and all-loving God, we bring you our praise, we bring you our worship, we open our hearts to you and tell of all you mean to us. We bless your name in a way that seeks to do justice to your greatness. Eternal and all-knowing God, we hunger to meet with you, to hear your voice, to know your will, to learn more of you, and to offer you an eager commitment that does justice to your love. Gracious and all-forgiving God, help us to acknowledge our faults, to confess our sins, to recognize our many weaknesses, and humbly be a people who are so grateful for your mercy. Great and all-transforming God, enable us to serve you more faithfully, love you more deeply, know you more fully, obey you more completely, and live in a way that does justice to your renewing power. May you receive our worship now and so help us to become the people you would have us to be, to the glory of your name. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And I'm very grateful now to Jim and Margaret Aird, who are going to bring us a reading this morning, which comes from Acts chapter 8 and is the story of Philip coming to the aid of an Ethiopian official in his quest for learning.
The reading is taken from the book of Acts, chapter 8, verses 26 to 39. Philip and the Ethiopian. Now an angel of the Lord said to Philip,
Go south to the road, the desert road, that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza.
So he started out, and on his way he met an Ethiopian eunuch, an important official in charge of all the treasury of the Kandake, which means Queen of the Ethiopians. This man had gone to Jerusalem to worship, and on his way home was sitting in his chariot reading the book of Isaiah the prophet. The Spirit told Philip,
Go to that chariot and stay near it.
Then Philip ran up to the chariot and heard the man reading Isaiah the prophet.
Do you understand what you're reading? How can I? He said, unless someone explains it to me.
So he invited Philip to come up and sit with him. This is the passage of scripture the eunuch was reading.
He was led like a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before its shearer is silent, so he did not open his mouth. In his humiliation, he was deprived of justice. Who can speak of his descendants? For his life was taken from the earth.
The eunuch asked Philip,
Tell me, please, who is the prophet talking about, himself or someone else?
Then Philip began with that very passage of scripture and told him the good news about Jesus. And as they travelled along the road, they came to some water. And the eunuch said,
Look, here is water. What can stand in the way of my being baptized?
And he gave orders to stop the chariot. Then both Philip and the eunuch went down into the water, and Philip baptized him.
When he came out of the water, The Spirit of the Lord suddenly took Philip away, and the eunuch did not see him again, but went on his way rejoicing. Thanks be to God.
As we continue in our series on the life and worship in the early church, we come, as I mentioned earlier, to the theme of learning in the early church. And we've heard a few times in recent weeks about Peter's great announcement to the crowds when the Holy Spirit came. As he preached the good news of Jesus that day, some 3,000 people accepted his message and were baptized. And what a result that was, and the power of the Holy Spirit to go from just a handful of disciples and followers to having 3,000 more in one day. As John Stott says in his commentary, it was as if a school was opened in Jerusalem that day, with Jesus's disciples, the apostles, as the teachers, and the new believers becoming 3,000 eager pupils. As we've read again in recent weeks, the new believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. They were eager to learn, and they had wonderful teachers because the apostles had each learned from listening and learning firsthand themselves from Jesus over the previous 3 years of being with him in his ministry. Hungry to learn and understand more and more of Jesus's teaching and example, the young believers sat at the apostles' feet and put into practice what they learned in devoted worship to God and in love and care for each other and for those in need around them. I wonder if you can remember a time when you couldn't learn enough about a particular topic or interest. Perhaps in following a particular musical artist or band or a football team, or training in a sport, or collecting stamps from around the world. There are many different things that could have taken our interest. And I remember a great many years ago now working as a volunteer with the RSPB on their Geltsdale Reserve in Cumbria for a month in the summer. It was a great time monitoring the bird life and also working on different tasks around the reserve each day. But the greatest delight for me was actually that the assistant warden had a speciality of botany. And I was able to go out with him on surveys and to learn from him the names of so many wildflowers that we came across. I was able to learn those names firsthand, and it was so exciting, much more exciting than going round with a book of wildflowers and trying to work out which each one was. Because the assistant warden was not only able to tell me what the flowers were, but he was also able to explain to me what their distinguishing features were and how you identified them. And with that foundation of learning, I was forever afterwards able to really enjoy going out and building up my knowledge of wildflowers wherever I went. I had that ground knowledge of all of those wildflowers he'd taught me. And then I also knew how to use the wildflower key for helping me to learn new wildflowers that I came across. And it's remained a real passion ever since, finding and knowing wildflowers in the different places where I go. And we can imagine the same sort of enthusiastic, beneficial learning for these young believers in the early church. Learning firsthand from the apostles. It gave an excellent grounding for them from which to keep on learning and building up faith and trust and understanding in who Jesus is and was and all that he had done. And what makes the young believers' learning so immediate and special is that they were not learning about a historical hero and his life and teaching. Fundamental to the power of the good news of Jesus is that he is a risen and living Saviour. His teaching is made real and authenticated by his resurrection. And it means that everything he ever said is true and that he is who he says he is as God's Son. The believers' hope and trust in him are therefore secure, and there is every reason to want to know more and more in order to live faithful lives for Jesus. And because Jesus is a living Saviour, he knows and is with each one of his followers to help them grow in faith and understanding and in closeness to him. We'll think a little bit more about learning in the early church in a moment, but first of all, we'll either listen to or join in, if you know it, the song by Keith and Kristen Getty called Speak, O Lord. And the words of that encourage us to be listening and following God's word for us today.
Speak, O Lord, and renew our minds. your glory.
We've thought about the young believers in Jerusalem being hungry to learn from the apostles' teaching in order to grow and become faithful disciples of Jesus. We turn now to the story in our passage today when Philip is sent on a divine errand to help an Ethiopian traveller in his desire to learn more. As a little introduction, Philip was one of those appointed along with Stephen and five others to help with food distribution to widows in the church community in Jerusalem. Traditionally, there had been tension between the Hebrew-speaking and Greek-speaking Jews. And in the young church, the Greek-speaking believers had noticed that their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution of food. So Philip was one of those appointed from the Greek-speaking community to sort this out and make everything fair and proper for everyone. A little while later, though, when persecution broke out following the death of Stephen, Philip went first of all to the city of Samaria, and there he preached the gospel and also healed many people. In our story, the Ethiopian official whom he is sent to is treasurer at the court of the Queen of Ethiopia. He is a God-fearing Gentile who has been to worship at Jerusalem, perhaps at the time of a great pilgrimage festival, and he is now returning home in his chariot along the wilderness road through the desert. Wanting to learn more of God as he journeys home, he is reading aloud from the book of Isaiah, and he's reading these words: "As a sheep led to slaughter, and quiet as a lamb being sheared, he was silent, saying nothing. He was mocked and put down, never got a fair trial. But who now can count his kin, since he's been taken from the earth?" Philip is directed by the Spirit to join the man in his chariot. As he runs alongside the chariot and hears what the man is reading, he is curious. He takes time to ask a question: "Do you understand what you're reading?" And the Ethiopian says, "How can I understand unless someone helps me?" And so Philip climbs up alongside him, but he still doesn't launch immediately into offering an explanation of the passage. He allows the Ethiopian chamberlain to ask what it is he is seeking to know. He asks, "Tell me, who is the prophet talking about, himself or some other?" And knowing, as he does now, that the prophet Isaiah was foretelling the self-sacrificial death of Jesus and his following glory in the words he wrote some hundreds of years before, Philip is given the perfect opportunity to preach the good news of Jesus to this Ethiopian inquirer as they continue to journey together. And the man is an enthusiastic inquirer and learner as he opens his heart to Philip in all that Philip teaches and unfolds to him. Having learned of Jesus and his being the one through faith in whom we are to be saved, the Ethiopian wastes no time in asking to be baptized by Philip there and then, just as they pass an available stream of water. And coming up out of the water, Philip is whisked away by the Spirit. His job as teacher is done. And though probably the Ethiopian was somewhat startled by this, he doesn't seem to mind. He's discovered what he wanted to know. He's received what he was looking for. And he goes on his way as happy as he could be, a new believer in Jesus Christ. I wonder, are we enthusiastic learners, just like the young believers in the early church in Jerusalem, and like the Ethiopian on his journey home? We are so privileged today to have Jesus's teaching, and indeed the teaching of some of the apostles like Peter, John, and of course later Paul, in our New Testament section of the Bible. We have all this to read and reflect upon, and in so many different translations today that keep giving us fresh insights into what we are reading and learning. Today also we have assorted Bible reading notes that we can use each day to help us explore and understand the different parts of the Bible so much better. We can see how the whole story of the Bible fits together as we understand and appreciate more and more the wonderful works of God. So many Christians today probably tend to spend most of their time reading the New Testament, and they explore the Old Testament far less. And that's probably because the New Testament books tend to reveal God as a loving God, while the Old Testament can seem more scary, with God seeming more angry and judgmental. We learn, though, through our passage today that reading the Old Testament expands and explains the New Testament for us. To read only the New Testament is like seeing only a part of a large, majestic painting. We can see a good part of the painting, and it is wonderful, but its true depth, its complete scope of composition and story only becomes clear when we can see the whole canvas and marvel even more at it. Kenny Borthwick, former minister at Wester Hills in Edinburgh, refers to the Bible as the book of the acts of the rejected God. The book of the acts of the rejected God. We can only understand that fully when we weave the Old Testament and the New Testament together. We see how God made everything good and had the hope of being in loving relationship always with us. And yet humanity has spoiled things, always wanting its own way and so often choosing to reject God. Yes, God judged his people because they forgot him and fell so far short in caring for each other. But in being rejected, God's grace abounds. Far from rejecting us, he sent Jesus, his son, to make all things new. And so God reset in motion his original plan that we be one with him and he with us, and find a glorious fulfillment living in communion with him through our faith in Jesus. In the kaleidoscope of books that make up the Bible, there is so much to learn about God's love for us. And I hope that wherever we are, wherever we're at in our journey of faith, that we are still eager to learn and explore more and more. There is always that fresh insight to gain, even in the most familiar of Bible passages. more to know of God, his heart and his purpose, his will for our lives, and what he would have us be and do. Perhaps one of the most helpful ways to learn together is in an opportunity where, like the Ethiopian official, we can ask questions and seek answers together. And that's an opportunity for me to plug the Bible study group that will begin again this month on Zoom. It's a great time to read a Bible passage together, explore it with questions and shared experience and insights together. And think about how we'll do things differently in the week ahead, in the light of what we've learned and read together. In the next little while in the Bible study group, we'll look at the book of Ephesians, the general letter that Paul wrote for the early church to guide and encourage them. So if you'd like to keep on learning from God's word, can I encourage you to join in? And you can do so just now, right from the comfort of your own home. We learn to grow closer to Jesus, to become more like him, and to become more useful to him. And so may we ever be eager to keep travelling on that journey. Now, I'm very grateful to Margaret and Craig Gordon, who will lead us in our prayers today.
Loving God, thank you for your gracious gifts to us, tokens of which we give back to you in our offerings made in different ways each week for the work of your church near and far. May we share all that you have given us for love of the world and to honour your name.
As we have thought about learning today, we thank you for all the opportunities we have to learn from books, from courses and lectures, from television and radio programmes and from the internet. Thank you for the freedoms and opportunity we have generally in our part of the world for our young people to attend school, college and university. Thank you that in this time of COVID-19, our schools are open again and children have the benefit of being back with friends and learning again together in the classroom. Thank you for the teachers who do such an amazing job of encouraging young people to learn.
As we think of the opportunities we have and our young people here have to learn, we remember those who have no such opportunities. We pray for families living in remote places with no schooling available, for families who don't have the money to send their children to school, for street children with no love or security or homes, let alone the opportunity to learn. We pray for those without the hope of further education, even though they have such ability and dreams of going far. We thank you for individuals and organisations working to bring community development in so many places of need and to offer the gift of learning to so many who have been without.
At home, here we think of young people now preparing to take their place at university and college. It's been a tough time with so much uncertainty over exam grades, but thank you that for so many, disappointment has turned to relief and the realisation of a hopeful place to study for their chosen career. We also think of those who are lost and frustrated amongst the restrictions of COVID-19, unable to get apprenticeships or jobs just now. We ask for openings for these young people too, and government schemes to help them get started.
As we pray for ourselves in your church, Lord, we pray that we can make the very most of opportunities to learn and grow in faith and knowing you. Help us have open, eager hearts and minds as we read and reflect on your word on our own or in Bible studies, discovering the joy of asking questions and gaining fresh insight. Thank you for Sunday school, messy church, scripture union groups, youth fellowship groups that all encourage our young people to grow in faith. We pray They can all be up and running again shortly, and thank you for creativity at present in finding fresh ways to come together. Thank you, Lord, for the wonder of learning and the wonder of your world around us. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.
Come towards the end of our time together this morning in our time of worship, and my grateful thanks to you again for joining this morning or whenever you have been able to join. My thanks go to those who've taken part again in today's service and also to the production team for making everything possible for today. In the week ahead, whatever you will be doing, whatever is coming up for you, I pray that you do know the Lord's presence with you. But now, as we finish and close today, may we say the grace together. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and evermore. Amen.